Nun zu Tomas Sedlacek und seine Frage, was treibt den Menschen an, außer seinem Eigennutz? Ist der Mensch mehr als ein Homo economicus? Well, yes, of course. That's also the thesis in your book, your best-selling book, Economics of Good and Evil. You have been an advisor to Václav Havel and you're on the National Economic Council of Prague. Please welcome one of the most discussed economists of these days, Tomáš Sedlacek, please. Take the seat in the middle, please.
Thank you. Good evening.
Very welcome. Mark and I have shared this task. I will kind of make the introduction and the lead, and he will push a little bit harder.
He'll make the conclusion.
If you're not clear enough, he will.
Okay. Clear as mud.
Nachhaken. Let's first talk about your main... No. Something else first. I see it on my note. You were described as one of the five hot minds in economics. Would you have expected something like this 10 years ago?
Well, I disagree with that, of course. But but no.
Mm-hmm.
Is it actually... You wanted the clear answer. I can give you a very long, unclear answer.
It's a good start, you know, and it fits to my next question. Is it actually true that Economics of Good and Evil was turned down as your dissertation?
Yes, yes.
So why was that? Was it not scientific enough?
Well, it's funny because I got three... We in the Czech Republic, we have three opponents to sort of give a judgment on it. Two of that was extremely positive. One was positive, but with some issues which could be solved in a month. But yet, it was turned down for reasons that I still do not understand. One of the dean said that after questioning him two times, but he's not here, this is unfair for me to answer. But the conclusion was that it was not written in an academically humble enough language. So I promise that I will write it next time in a more humble academic language.
All right, don't do it right now.
No,
I'm fine with the language here. As I said, the main focus of your book and of your thinking is human beings are not driven by greed only. There is more. There is the good besides the evil. This sounds very popular in this time. We also had the Abzocker Initiative in Switzerland. I don't know if you know it. But, you know, if I look what is happening over history, isn't it a bit naive? Because greed is in our genes.
Yeah, of course. I'm very naive, but then again, what's more naive than to believe that human beings are rational, optimizing agents? I mean, that to me is naive, to start with. But I'm happy. I'm very naive. I'm young, and I'll be naive as long as I can be naive, and unless proven otherwise, I'll try to be optimistically naive. And I see around me, unfortunately, this might be a Czech sort of a thing, but you know, many of my colleagues are what I call professional cynics. They get paid for being cynical. Which happens...
You think they're cynical?
Yes, 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 and they're very proud of it. My colleagues, and also we see this sort of fashion in politics as well. You know, let's screw it all, you know, there's no point in trying to do this. Which is in a way interesting. But to give an interesting answer to your interesting question, this question of greed, wanting more than you have, it's funny because you can trace it. This is one of the oldest demons, if you will, or one of the oldest archetypes in the ever recorded history of mankind. You can go, let's take our culture, so we can go down into the Bible and you can read the original sin, really, as a sin of overconsumption. You know, because in the medieval times, it was usually interpreted as a sin of sexual nature. That's the original sin, and everybody is dirty because they were born begotten in sex. But there's nothing about sex in the first chapters of Genesis. But there is one word that is repeated 14 times, and that's the word consume. Do not consume the fruit, they consume da-da-da-da. So, to me, it's a sin of consumption of something that they didn't need because they didn't consume it out of hunger, nor did they get dressed out of being cold. They got dressed because they felt ashamed. So you can see a very big link between an internal psychological feeling that is sort of complemented on the outside of having an exterior shield between you and the outer world. So, you know, so it's one of the oldest demons. Even the curse that Eve gets, you know, economics is about demand and supply. So Eve gets the curse of demand. You will desire, but your desires will not be with you. You will not control them. They will control you and they will drive you crazy. And Adam, the poor man, he gets, I see there's more males here, so I can be slightly chauvinistic.
As always,
on yeah.
occasions like this.
But the poor guy gets a curse of supply. Even with the technology of the 21st century, with all these gadgets and cell phones and internet and Wi-Fi, no matter how hard you work, it will not be enough to supply her desires.
Okay, let's take a break. Mark had the opportunity now to listen and to really think. I didn't. I needed to think about my next question. So let's give him the chance to ask something smart.
That issue, Tomáš, of greed in everyone's genes, in every investor's genes, isn't that exactly what central banks are stoking now? Are stoking now. That greed. You don't get paid for leaving your money just in the bank account or buying the safe asset. Yeah. You need to be greedy to survive really in these times in financial markets.
The whole problem of today's crisis, so to speak, is that we don't desire enough. It is not that we don't have anything to eat, that we don't have oil, or that the supply is broken. No, the problem is on the demand side. Mm-hmm. And the problem is as follows. We don't demand enough. Mm-hmm. So the fiscal policy, fiscal policy and monetary policy are basically tricks. Fiscal policy is trying to pretend as if there is demand while there is no demand. The government sort of pretends that when the markets are weak, when the economy is weak, the government pretends to desire to demand in its stead. And monetary policy is simply pretending that there is money where there is no money. And that there is liquidity where there is no liquidity. And you can play these tricks for a little while, of course, but as we all know, you can't fool all the people. You can fool almost all, but not all the people for all time. So you can play these tricks for a little while, But you can't be playing them forever, and that's why. The thing with monetary policy is that is not under the discretion of politicians. Now, Mark, there is a lot of debates about democracy today. Now, Mark, that monetary policy, unlike fiscal policy, monetary policy isn't, how should I put it, democratic as we are used to it. We do not vote. We do not elect our governor. And just imagine how would it look like if we would. Even an educated nation such as Switzerland would probably vote for somebody who would be ready to print money. I mean, if you had a choice of two governors and one would say, well, I guarantee you stable CPI, and the other one, well, I guarantee you 10,000 Swiss francs a month because, look, yes, we can. It's, you know, just, it's easy. I'm afraid that the second one would win.
But are you suggesting that this game of tricks might be coming to an end soon?
Yes. Or? Yes.
So walk me through, how will it play out?
Well, okay, one way how I look at our growth is that this growth that we've experienced in the past wasn't really ours. You know, there's a lot of diagnosis, a lot of people, you can hear this from analysts and politicians all the time, that the diagnosis is that the economy is depressed. I think that's a misdiagnosis. It's a very serious misdiagnosis. The economy is not depressed, the economy is manic depressed. And it's a bipolar disorder. That's a completely different sickness. And our problem is not the depression only. I would even say the bigger problem is the manias, as you know very well from 2001 to 2007, 2008. And the American crisis, you know, Greece is something that's completely irrelevant. Greece to me is uninteresting. It isn't the kernel of the crisis. The kernel of the crisis is the Irish example. You know, to put it in a funny way, and I was asked to be provocative, so I will.
Really?
Yes.
Who did?
You said so, I think, even.
All right.
You know, a Greek example is an example of, let's say, now I'm really simplifying here. It's a depressed economy, and between the lines you can read, so if the Greeks worked twice as much or twice as efficiently, gathered their taxes, whatever, they wouldn't have a problem. All right, don't agree, but let's take a look on Ireland. Isn't there the case exactly the opposite? That's the manic case. If Irish, and please understand, Irish bankers are no idiots. I mean, those were the top university trained, very much Catholic, very, you know, moral, if there is a nation that sort of cares about these things, that would be Ireland. Isn't the case in Ireland exactly the opposite like in Greece? You know, if Irish bankers work half the time, they wouldn't have a problem.
Can I?
You know.
I would
and
like
that's
to...
what we need to, that's what we need to, and sorry, I didn't answer the question. Just very quickly, the growth thing. So to me, it's like a wave. When you have a wave, it takes the energy of the surrounding levels of the, so it forms a wave, but the level of water around it goes flat. I argue that our growth that we have seen in 2001 to 2009 is of that nature. It wasn't ours. We vacuum cleaned the surrounding. Very briefly, we took the energy from the past, which is petrol, mineral, and fossil fuels. That's basically solar energy, if you will, of the past. Just imagine how our growth would look like without petrol. I mean, it would not, no flights, no globalization, and growth would be much slower. So we took that. We also took the energy from the future, and that's debt, and also, in a way, inflation, because you have to pay that back by disinflation later, which slows down the economy. So we've taken the energy from the future. We've also taken the energy from the surrounding. Let's say, not only did we sort of gather the golds and enslave the world as Europeans, but also international trade was advantageous for the poor, but much more advantageous for us. So, and the third sort of energy that we took is, let's say, a vertical, which is innovation. I claim that all of these sources, except maybe innovation, there we don't know, are running out. We are running out of fossil fuels, sooner or later. We are running out of debt, sooner or later. Greece has already run out. America's running out. Even Germany is running out. And okay. We are running out of these things.
So, I would like to step in here, because it's exactly the point where Mark and I wanted to go. You know, if you are, if you have a certain wish that we become more moderate, that there is not only economic growth, and we have 40 years of Club of Rome, then would you agree that the problem, or would you state that this problem is solving itself?
It will one way or another. Either we will do the moderation moderately, or we will do the moderation quickly. It's like when you're addicted to a drug. And let's say deficits are that sort of a drug. You know, the government deficit increases the mood of the economy. Like, I don't know, speed. That's a good name of a drug because it sort of gives you speed. So, you know, the proper Keynesian debate was, should we use this drug or should we not use this drug? Nobody questions this anymore. Everybody says, yes, 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 let's use it. And the only question is, how much? My point here is, the drug is running out. We're out of speed. And we're all addicted to speed, and we can either detox moderately and do the slowdown slowly, or you do it like Greeks. Greeks are not, properly speaking, behind us. Greeks are ahead of us. They've just bankrupted, I say, 10 or 20 years before everybody else. As you could see very nicely in Cyprus, Portugal, Spain, and others. So respect the Greeks. They were always ahead with democracy, with philosophy and everything.
We have actually three main topics that we wanted to discuss with you. One is what we've just had, except if Mark wants to put another question. Otherwise, we would like to talk with you shortly about the European debt crisis. That was the topic here before you came. You know, what would be a smart question here? How much surprised were you about this? I guess you didn't anticipate anything of this like everybody else.
Yeah, well, first of all, it's not a European debt crisis, it's a Western debt crisis. It has very little to do with Europe. I mean, it started in America, as far as I remember. And if you recall, 2 years ago, there was this beautiful thing where America was in the crisis. This was 2008, and Europe was still doing fine. And we had all these academics that were very smart about, you know, we even called it the European Schadenfreude, which is interesting because In English, they don't have a word for Schadenfreude, so they have to use the German word, which also says a lot about the mentality of the nation. But rest at peace, in my language, we have three synonyms for Schadenfreude.
Oh, really?
Yes, it's sort of a national hobby. But in English, it doesn't exist. But there were all these articles, you must recall, the European Schadenfreude. Now we have finally proven to the world that American system is foul and the European system is better. The Americans go up and they go down. They have all these bubbles, as we debated just a minute ago. But not we. We are the stable. And even if the crisis hits us, we are ready because we have our social system, so we are not worried about da-di-da-di. And then it came, of course. And now, suddenly, it was American crisis 2 years ago, and now it's a European crisis. Also marked the difference in the reaction of Americans and Europeans. That's what really worried me, still worries me. Just imagine that the crisis starts in America, and the Americans go, oh, let's disassemble the United States of America. California's bankrupt, let's help them by kicking them out of the dollar zone. Nobody in his right or her right mind comes up with an idea like that.
But as we heard, we're not the Vereinigten Staaten of Europe.
Yes, yes. But we have reacted in that way.
But Tomáš, if we've had the European debt crisis with us for more than 3 years now, if Chancellor Merkel called us or called you today asking for your advice, how should we act to get this crisis behind us, to get the Eurozone on stable footing again?
Yeah.
What would your advice be?
Yeah. I will...
Just a simple solution is fine.
Okay, simple solution. Okay. Confiscate fiscal policy like we have confiscated monetary policy from the hands of politicians. Yeah. Government basically has two hands to influence, not direct, but influence the economy. One is called monetary policy. The other one is fiscal. This is sort of economics one-on-one.
So how do I confiscate fiscal
policy? Monetary policy is basically the monopoly of the government to print money. Again, this is extremely simplified, but you get the point. Fiscal policy is very different. That's the monopoly of the government to print debt. What we've done, we as a Western civilization came to the conclusion that it's not very clever for politicians to be tempted by the ability of having a printing machine in their backyard. If you have problems with controlling yourself sexually, it is not a good idea to do so in a bar full of beautiful ladies. Yeah. So we said, okay, let's confiscate that. The monetary hand, it's impossible for a politician, or very difficult for a politician to control.
Okay, I can follow you until here.
Yeah.
Now
I'll give a little bit of an explanation with the Lord of the Rings. There, you see, you must have noticed this. You know, you're all executive people. The first question that comes to one's mind is, who is the CEO of the Rings? It's called the Lord of the Rings, so the natural question is, who is the boss of the Rings? Who is the CEO? And you will see that in it looks like Mordor is the master of the ring. The ring was forged in order to give Mordor more power and more, let's say, power. But at the end of the day, you learn that the food chain is reversed. If you destroy the ring, you destroy Mordor. This is exactly what happened with us and with the debt. We were taking on debt in exactly the belief that we can increase the degrees of freedom. Now we have become the slaves of our own debt. We even call it debt service. I mean, every budget has a... When you pay your debt, we call it debt service. So, you know, once you take these things literally. But I'm making...
But that's the analysis.
Analysis,
sorry.
Yeah.
Now, what's the solution?
The solution is the ring of power must be destroyed. Because it was too tempting. Notice that nobody of the wise ever touched the ring because it was too tempting. Not even Gandalf the White touched the ring because he knew it would be deceptive. So this is what we have already done with monetary policy. Now, this needs to be done with fiscal policy as well. What I mean exactly is the nation should have an absolute democratic right to decide whether they want to live in a low-tax country with low government expenditure, like the United States of America, for example, or high-tax with high expenditure, such as the Nordics. But this should not be allowed. Low taxes, high expenditure. This is a basic schizophrenia that we, most European countries, live in. And we can measure that schizophrenia to the last penny, and that's called budget deficit. This needs to be confiscated. Governments should not be able to print debt like they're not able to print money. That's the short answer that you wanted.
I haven't quite understood what you would tell Angela Merkel if she asked you for advice. But basically, does it mean that we should prohibit governments to go into debt at all?
Yeah. No. We should, in the most extreme reading, is the government should not be able to enter markets for debt. Debt should be rationed, like money is rationed. Your government, well, you can, not, well, you could before you, the Swiss could before you pegged. But no government can print money, but they can print debt at will. And you know more better than I do that markets are not strong enough to stop the governments from printing money. I mean, markets do not have a strong enough whip to for the government to go, oh my God, my spreads have gone up by 20 basis points. I must borrow less. What happens is they borrow more because the debt service goes up and everything.
But isn't that kind of a utopian world? When I look at the reality, European countries are in that pile of debt, and by deciding not to add on more debt, that existing debt won't go away.
No,
we have to. How do we get out of this problem we're in now?
We have to pay it back. This is, I think, one of the basic sort of misunderstandings I read many times in the press is that the role of the economist is to increase GDP growth. Wrong. The role of an economist, if there is one, should be to decrease the amplitude of a business cycle, but not to increase GDP growth. If you want to help, so that means increasing GDP growth while the economy is on its knees, but decreasing GDP growth when the economy is manic, so to speak. You can't have one without the other unless you really want to run your country bankrupt. Like if you want to have periods of massive inflation, you also have to have periods of massive disinflation, otherwise you ruin the currency.
Now, when you say all that debt has to be paid back, wouldn't history teach us that the most probable way is that it'll be inflated away? Which is a form of repayment.
Which is the same thing. You're just exporting your problems to your creditors.
And which path would you give? Would you, as an economist,
pay it back.
give the biggest probability?
Now that we have independent ECB, it shouldn't be technically possible to inflate ourselves out of debt. Technically. That doesn't mean... You know, they often say that it's not possible in... It's possible in theory, but not in practice. I mean, we should be speaking exactly the other way around. It's possible. It works in theory, but it doesn't... it works in practice, but it doesn't work in theory. And that's the problem with economics. It somehow works, but we don't know how. But naive. What do you mean naive? 100 years ago, the idea to confiscate monetary policy must have been even more naive. This is a modest proposal compared to what we've already done. And now you see that this is exactly the reason why Europe does not have a problem with inflation. Our inflation is still, even today, pretty good. Because politicians can't play with it. They can't play these tricks. Our problem is excessively on the side of the fiscal policy because that's the only hand that the governments have, so to speak, to battle with, to be populist, also one way to put it. So either we let loose both of these hands and we get to where we've always been, or we tie these hands back and we stop using these tricks.
Are you confident that this will happen?
This is the only way how we can regain back the trust of investors. Nobody will trust a politician who says, when growth comes back, we will be having budget surpluses. I mean, you would have to be quite naive to believe that. But if we say, okay, we're giving away the right to decide how much deficit will or surplus will be on that given year, either to a national body like it was in the national banks before ECB, or a central European body such as ECB, or just give it a simple rule that when the economy is growing, we will be running budget surpluses, and there will be no discretion in that. Then that's the moment that you can start trusting the government, well, the fiscal even in the depth of a crisis. And I don't want to be a bad prophet, but if the crisis continues and we see more countries go bankrupt, especially bigger countries, not Greece, not Cyprus, not Hungary, not Ireland, not Iceland, those were all luckily very small countries which we should have used as a role model sort of case example, as sort of how to deal with these things. Then it might come a day when the decision will be either Spain will go down and with it the rest, all of Europe, or tomorrow we give away fiscal policy and we have a common fiscal policy like Japan. I mean, if you split Japan into 27, just imagine, split Japan into 27 fiscal constituencies, a third of Japan would be bankrupt.
All right. I'm looking at the watch, and I would like to touch a third topic. Tomorrow we will talk about trust and confidence, and it is all over in the news now, offshore leaks. Offshore leaks means more transparency, but will it make the financial industry a better place?
You see, the fundamental problem of the crisis was that there was too much trust. Markets should have never been trusted so much. Governments should have been never trusted that much. Rating agencies shouldn't have been trusted that much. So I'm not all hoping for this trust to come back because it was unhealthy. It was fundamentally wrong. We can't set interest rates. I mean, if we could set interest rates, and we can't, for Greece, then Greece would be a bankruptcy business as usual. I mean, we've been lending to hundreds of countries for hundreds of years. I mean, one of them has to go bankrupt sooner or later. But no, it was a religious sort of a breakdown. It was a breakdown of the whole system. That was what was at play. So we have to come to the to understanding that interest rates is something that is spooky, that we do not understand. And Aristotle said this 2,300 years ago. Don't use it. There's something spooky about it. We don't understand it. Don't trust it. I mean, and if you have to use it very carefully.
So there was too much trust, you're saying, but no. It's the basis of doing business. And if the customers trusted the asset managers too much, I can understand, but you mean everybody had too much trust and confidence?
Yes, we can see this very clearly. Interest rates were too low. Greek interest rates, for example, sovereign interest rate, was too low. That's why we couldn't take the blow. In other words, we couldn't calculate the risk component, which is exactly to hedge ourselves. This is the whole thing, and this is another topic. How do you calculate interest rate? Well, basically, the main gravitor there is the probability of bankruptcy. So it was all, the whole system was evolving around it, but when it actually happened, it looked like, I like to give it an example, it's like a car with an airbag. This is how our financial system works, the system that you and I work in every day. It's like a car with an airbag, and that airbag works all the time, except for a car crash. Mm-hmm.
So, now, when you say that example with Greece having way too low interest rates, I think yesterday, French government bond yield touched a 260-year low, basically an all-time low, and many countries have that. The United States has it. I mean, aren't we just back to that people are trusting markets and this is too much?
This is the irony of the whole thing. Everybody agrees what led us to the crisis was too much consumption on credit. What will lead us out of the crisis? Even more consumption on credit. What led us into the crisis? Too low, in the case of Fed especially, too low interest rates. Well, what will get us out of the crisis? Even lower interest rate, only screw it, you can't really go beyond zero, which we've learned that you can. But you can't really, you know, give people money for lending it. So this is sort of a thing that appears in psychoanalysis, now that we're in Switzerland, when you encounter a fetish. You know, fetish promises you the way out of it, but the more you, the deeper you go. And I was just having this debate at ECB, and I don't know if you've been in Frankfurt, they're building this new building, and they were showing me from the old building to the new building, and next to it was a church. So I said, I mean, what more do you need to sort of credo in Latin means faith. So one way how to read the credit crunch, it's a faith crunch. We trusted something that wasn't, the religion looked like believable, but it wasn't believable. This is why people hate us, not because we have too much money. I mean, a lot of artists have ridiculously high salaries for paintings that I don't think are worth a penny. A lot of sports people get a lot of money for running quickly. Well, what's the social benefit of that? You know, if you talk about these things. So I don't think that the problem. The problem there is that we have breached our faith. We have been telling the world that, you know, we understand the system. You politicians, you idiots, don't meddle, bugger off, laissez-faire, laissez-passer. And then comes, and we go like, please meddle. Please do something. We don't have a clue of what to do. You solve it. And that's why we get this sort of rage, which is, I think, deserved.
How would you define the new kind of confidence that is necessary?
Well, the funny thing is, to put it in the larger picture, what led us into the crisis? Economics. This is an economic crisis. What will lead us out of the crisis? Even more economics. So you see the fetish component working there. Again,
that's what I wanted to say. It's not politics who can lead us out of the crisis.
It's, I would say, less economics, less economic way of thinking, less economic belief that economy will solve everything, that everything will be solved by growth. You know, we've already been there. We've done it. We have a T-shirt and a bag of chips. We've had a lot of growth, and I like to give of course, everything is easier with growth. But if it doesn't happen, and I never prayed, a lot of people think that I'm against growth. No, I'm just saying that if it isn't happening, it isn't happening. And, you know, you can be standing there at a ship, no wind. And we've been doing this in Europe for 3 years, standing there, flat sails going, come on. So, you know, we can do this for 2 weeks, but, you know, most people get bored. So maybe say, okay, there is no wind, let's do something else. Let's go swimming, or let's, you know, go and reshuffle, or let's do something else, but let's just not try and produce or manufacture growth. That's what led us into the crisis. It wasn't the lack of growth, it was too much growth. And that was, of course, steroided by deficits, and that's our problem. And one last point to this question, United States of America did not enter the recession after they slowed down. No, it was exactly the other way. It was a full-throttle bankruptcy. They were flying low unemployment, high levels of growth, high productivity, da-di-da-di-da. The world was rosy. And suddenly, out of nothing, bang, full-throttle bankruptcy, run into the wall. It's like Ireland also. Very competitive, very rich, great banking sector. Everything was hallelujah until it wasn't.
What makes you confident that we won't just repeat the same mistakes?
Pain.
You think that pain has been big enough to change us?
I'm not sure. This is the question that I... So if you have a toothache, for example, and the pain is little, you will go mañana, 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 and you will have... In Czech Republic, this is how we solve everything, not by growth, but by shots of alcohol. So when you have a pain in your tooth and it's bearable, you have a shot of whatever and it lasts you through the day. If the pain increases, you go and see the doctor or the dentist within half an hour. And that's sort of the level of pain that you need in order for this to happen. And I don't know what more do we need. We've already have, I don't know how many, four, five, six countries on life support. That wouldn't survive on market aid only, and it's beginning to be quite serious. And I am a believer in crisis or catharsis. I mean, Jung, your, and my very favorite sort of a thinker said that nothing changes outside of a crisis, the least of which is human nature. This is something that we should use to change our ways. And this was the topic of Davos last year, the great transformation, looking for new models. So you could even see a little bit of repentance in there. Davos is always a place where everybody goes and shows off. And that was sort of the tribunal of capitalism. And suddenly it was we've done something wrong, we don't know exactly what, but we want to change it. And that's the definition of repentance in classical theology.
In your book, you gave us a walk through the history of economics, basically, which spanned thousands of years back. Give us a little vision for the future. What will the world look like? Not 2,000 years from now, but 20 years from now.
Could I do 100 so that nobody remembers my prophecy? 20 years from now, okay, so I think we will survive this. I am a great believer in, I mean, if you compare the continents, the United States, America, and Japan, for example, and you look at it as a whole, we have least to worry about.
You mean United States, Europe, and Japan?
Yeah.
We in Europe have least to worry
yes.
about, okay?
Yes. We have the lowest debt to GDP ratio. Our currency seems to be quite stable. We still have a lot of energy from integration, so to speak. In America, the cake is already baked. There's nothing you can do with it. The only thing you can do in America is actually quantitative easing. This is the only thing that they have left. They can't really go much on the fiscal anymore. Maybe they can go for 2 more years and then Krugman will finish writing his articles. But here, we in Europe, we can still go, we have a lot of energy from integration. There is a huge potential in integrating. Secondly, I sort of believe in the European dream more than I believe in the American dream. And we Europeans are not aware that we have a dream because we can't put it so exactly like Americans do. But this is the nature of dreams. I mean, dreams are fuzzy. Dreams are very difficult to describe. Dreams are not, I went to a shop and I met my mother and I shot her. I mean, dreams don't happen that way. It's much more complicated. You don't know what you're really dreaming. But one way to look at it is our dreams are much larger than the American dream, which is very much consumerist. And even the freedom there is the freedom to work and to consume the way you like it. But this is something that's sort of revolting to, or this is something that we don't like. We Europeans have, ever since the time immemorial, we have a tendency to think ourselves that we are living at the end times. Ever since the New Testament, we are waiting for the end that we have caused. So we are at the same time cradle and also the graveyard of culture. And I think, okay, to give you a short answer, if there was a man or a woman who was to fix or come up with a new system, and I'm using all the stereotypes imaginable, this is exactly why I'm doing it, I would rather it be European than American and Japanese.
The European dream, an interesting topic for a place in Switzerland or for an event in Switzerland. We could go on this, but it's very good to hear this with emphasis. Thank you very much. We have to make a point. Last question, are you a soccer fan? Football?
I like no, Socrates. Sorry.
No, not. All right. You know FC Basel? The best Swiss club is playing tonight and you can watch. Now I need to address the audience.
I think you find more support there than
looks
here.
Like, looks like you can watch. Sie können den Match heute Abend, diesen wichtigen Match, anschauen. Wir haben das für Sie vorbereitet, damit es für niemanden von Ihnen einen Grund gibt, den Event vorzeitig zu verlassen. Thank you very much, Tomáš Sedlacek.
It was my great pleasure.
Are you staying for dinner?
For a little bit, yes.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you.